Good morning. Today's scripture is found in Psalm 103, verses 1 through 3 and 8 through 12. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget none of his benefits. Who pardons all our iniquities, who heals all our diseases. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in loving kindness. He will not always strive with us, nor will he keep his anger forever. He has not dealt with us according to our sins, nor rewarded us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his loving kindness towards those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us.
Please stand.
Thank you.
Let's pray. Thank you, Lord, for this day. Thank you for the blessings you've given us. Thank you so much for Jesus Christ and salvation that we have in him. Lord, it is because of what he did on the cross and what he accomplished to defeat sin, death, and the grave. Lord, in this we rejoice. It excites us. And because of what you have accomplished, it sends through our minds and our heart and into our lives, overflowing into every aspect of our life, such gratitude and appreciation. Lord, I pray for your church today. I pray for Long Branch Baptist Church. I pray for all of our sister churches in the Sumter area. Lord, I pray for the churches all over this country and all over this world. God, I ask that your Holy Spirit is welcome there today. I pray, Father, that regardless of the circumstances and the situations that people are in today, I pray, Lord, that they would make worship a top priority. Lord, I lift up the church in Canada today, Lord, and the pastor there who has made a very bold stand to continue to meet and to fellowship because the Word of God says that we are not to forsake the assembling of ourselves together. God, I ask that where he is in custody right now, that you would give him strength, that you would encourage his heart, give courage to his efforts. Lord, I pray for his wife and his children. I pray, Father, for them that you would strengthen them through all of this. And Lord, the congregation itself, God, I pray that, Lord, you will not allow this to tear them apart, but only strengthen their resolve to obey the Word of God. And God, I pray that resolve would be translated to us here in America. God, I pray that you would revive your church. Lord, we pray for the songs that are being sung, the offerings that will be given, that, Lord, we would give with generosity and love. Lord, the Word of God that is about to be opened and declared before our ears today, I pray, Father, that you use the Scripture, use the message. Lord, may it infiltrate our lives so that, Lord, we would leave this place today, changed people for your glory. And it will be in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Hymn 511, the solid rock. Let's sing the first, the second, and the last, please.
Sweet spring, our heavenly
Let's take our Bibles and turn to Colossians chapter 1. We haven't done this in a while, but I want to ask if you would please, let's all stand in honor for the reading of God's Word. I hope and pray that this message will be not just a blessing to you, but also a challenge. But let's begin reading in verse number 9 for context, but we will be focusing on verses 21 to 23. For this reason also, since the day we heard of it, we have not ceased to pray for you and to ask that you may be filled with the knowledge of His will in all spiritual wisdom and understanding, so that you will walk in a manner worthy of the Lord, to please Him in all respects, bearing fruit in every good work, and increasing in the knowledge of God, strengthened with all power according to His glorious might, for the attaining of all steadfastness and patience, joyously giving thanks to the Father who has qualified us to share in the inheritance of the saints in light. For He rescued us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of His beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by Him all things were created, both in the heavens and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities. All things have been created through Him and for Him. He is before all things, and in Him all things hold together. He is also head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, and He Himself will come to have first place in everything. For it was the Father's good pleasure for all the fullness to dwell in Him, and through Him to reconcile all things to Himself, having made peace through the blood of His cross. Through Him I say, whether things on earth or things in heaven. And although you were formerly alienated and hostile in mind, engaged in evil deeds, yet He has now reconciled you in His fleshly body through death, in order to present you before Him holy and blameless and beyond reproach, if indeed you continue in the faith, firmly established and steadfast, and not moved away from the hope of the gospel that you have heard, which was proclaimed in all creation under heaven, and of which I, Paul, was made a minister. Father, thank you for your word, the power of your word resides in the power of the one who spoke it. So God, we ask that you would speak to us today. And Lord, may we be resolved this day to honor and glorify you in a way that is pleasing to you by the way we live, by the way we act, by what we profess. So God, we ask that you would be first place in us today. And we ask these in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. The power of if. We parents know the power of if. How many times have we told our kids who want to go and play at Billy's house or at Susie's house, who wants to go and do this, that, and the other, and we say, do you have your homework done? No. Do you have your chores finished? No. Well, if you do everything you know you're supposed to do, then you may be able to go and play or do whatever. We understand the power of if. But I think, unfortunately, when we see the word if in Scripture, we begin to think in the same circles as if I do, then God is required. You need to understand something about our salvation as New Testament believers. As the church, the covenant that Christ made with His church is not a conditional covenant.
In fact, it is much like, if not very much like, the covenant that God made with Abraham. Do you remember so long ago when God said to Abraham, I'm going to make of you a great nation. Look up to the stars and see if you can count them. For if you can count the stars, you will know the number of your descendants. And it was the scripture that told us that it was by faith there that Abraham believed, and it was accounted to him as righteousness. Now, to seal this covenant that God was making with Abraham, there would be a sacrifice that is made. And you can go back to Genesis, and the Bible tells us very clearly that Abraham had several different animals that he cut in half. And as was custom in those days, two people who were having an unbreakable, unconditional covenant with one another would walk through where the blood or where the carcasses have been separated and blood is walking through. And this is a reminder to those who are making a covenant that if either of us break this covenant, may what happened to these animals happen to me. So this was serious. So as that day, he had already, he cut the animals in half and the blood was draining right there in the midst of the pathway, just as they could walk through. And all throughout the day, Abraham did his best to keep the buzzards and the birds of prey from coming in on top of those animals and desecrating those animals. And as the evening came, a heavy sleep fell on Abraham, and he fell asleep. But he was able to see in a vision God, a smokestack, if you will, a furnace going through that. And what was God saying? This covenant is between you and me, but this covenant is dependent upon me alone. This is much like what Jesus said at the Last Supper. He says, this covenant that I'm making is in my blood. And I will seal this covenant on the cross. The disciples did everything they could by complaining and even trying to stop Jesus, but his mind was made up. The power of if. So with that in mind, I want you to understand here when we look here at verse number 23 again in just a few moments, that this if is not dependent upon you, but is dependent upon Christ and what he did. Just in review, let me ask you real quickly, are these particular characteristics, as we have been studying this so far, are these present in you? For example, faith. Is faith present in you? Paul here told of the disciple, or told of the Colossians there, he says, since the day that we heard of your faith in Christ. What about love? Has your faith spilled over into love so that you love people more so than you ever did before? And I tell you, a person who comes to faith and is completely changed by Christ, they may hate everybody in the world, but when they come to know Christ, they all of a sudden feel an overwhelming sensation in their own heart. Not saying it's a feeling like something that you can describe, but all of a sudden their mind is changed. You see, you cannot continue, you cannot have the faith that God provides and continue to walk in the hatred and animosity with those around you. If you say, preacher, I know I'm a Christian, but man, I work with some people or I live with some people that are just, you just don't know, then God can give you the love that is necessary. And if I would give you an illustration, but I don't want to incriminate anyone in my family who may watch this later on, but the truth of the matter is, I've got illustrations within my own family who know for a fact that living with someone who is absolutely abhorrent and is just the last, you just can't take it anymore, yet they surrendered themselves to the Lord and began loving that person in spite of it all, and how God has changed their relationship. What about faith? What about love? What about hope? Are you still within this mindset that, oh, we just can't wait till God comes back and just takes us out of this mess? Or do you see hope in spite of the mess that we're in? If the Lord doesn't come back for 100 years, folks, do you understand what we could potentially be facing in the days ahead? We might be like the pastor up in Canada. We may be experiencing, if we just by virtue of being an American and we say we have the freedom of speech, we may end up losing out on certain aspects of our freedoms and the things that we enjoy. This cancel culture is literally getting everything and getting into everything. Just recently saw yesterday how a law professor or a lawyer was asked to go to a particular college for this next semester. And he says, well, I would love to come and teach law at your school, but I feel like I need to at least let you know you do understand I represented Donald Trump. Oh, well, in that case, and they canceled his class. This is a cancel culture. Facebook is now increasing their guidelines and or holding stronger standards, even to the extent that your faith does not matter. And you begin to speak out on your faith, you could eventually lose your platform on Facebook. This is the cancel culture that we're in. What about not only faith, but love, but hope? And are you increasing in being fruitful as a Christian? As you hear Paul here say concerning the Colossian church, since the day we heard of it, you are increasing in your love. And we want you to increase all the more. In fact, what a great example that we find in Epaphras or Epaphras in Colossians. He sees Paul. He comes to faith. And what does he do? He immediately has the burden to do what? Go back and tell people who do not know Christ. And he goes back to Colossians or to Colossae. And all of a sudden, Philemon comes to faith. Philemon's wife comes to faith. Their son comes to faith. Other people come to faith. And all of a sudden, a church is formed, and they're meeting in Philemon's home. And now, because of this letter, or we understand that they were also faced with a possible heresy that was creeping in. But he's a great example. Epaphras is a great example, one who received the truth, and then took it back to his people. He also would report to Paul, and therefore that's why we have this letter. Here's what we're facing, Paul. Here's what's happening. The Lord has done great wonders, but here's what's going on. Let me ask you this question. Does faith manifest itself in your life? Does faith manifest itself in your life? Notice the progression here in verse 4. Since we heard of it, your faith in Christ Jesus and the love which you have for all the saints, because of the hope laid up for you in heaven, of which you previously heard of the word, in the word of truth, the gospel which has come to you. The progression starts with faith, and those who are in the faith continue to grow in the faith. Paul heard the Colossians' faith, which overflowed into love. And by the way, again, while it's not automatic, Jesus said that love is the evidence of being a disciple. By this you shall know that all men shall know that you're my disciples, the love that you have one for another. Faith is always accompanied by varying forms of fruit. Jesus himself equated the gospel with seed, and we've already talked about this before, about how the seed, everything, all the genetic information that is necessary for that plant, that fruit, that tree or whatever it is to sprout, to grow and produce fruit, is in that little seed. So faith is always accompanied by varying forms of fruit. To say that we have faith, but we do not possess the things that accompany faith, then we are either stagnant in our faith, and I believe Christians can be stagnant in our faith, or we don't really have faith like we think we do. The power of if. You see, faith without love is a hypocritical and meaningless faith. Write this down in your notes. 1 Corinthians 13, verses 1 through 3 and 13. Paul, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, says, "If I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, but do not have love, I have become a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and know all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. And if I give all my possessions to feed the poor, and if I surrender my body to be burned, but do not have love, it profits me nothing. But now faith, hope, love abide these three, but the greatest of these is love." So faith without love is a hypocritical and meaningless faith. Secondly, faith without knowledge and understanding is an immature faith. Faith without knowledge and understanding is an immature faith. Have you ever heard someone say, "Hey, do you know," maybe you've asked somebody, "Hey, do you know how to do plumbing? Can you do electrical work?" You know, somebody who's always trying to look for a better deal. And hey, I've been there, you know. Look for somebody who can do it without having to pay a lot of money for it. And maybe you've heard somebody say, "Well, I know enough to be dangerous." Which means they can get the job done, but they don't want the responsibility for it. But folks, let me tell you something. That is not the way it should be in the church. No one should have just enough knowledge to be dangerous. In fact, how damning is that? For a pastor, for a Sunday school teacher, for any Christian whatsoever, to actually just know enough. Folks, let me tell you right now, you could spend hours upon hours looking at the people who make videos on YouTube who think they have enough knowledge. But all they've found is they have enough knowledge to condemn their own souls. So faith without love is a hypocritical and meaningless faith. Faith without knowledge and understanding is immature faith. Write this down. Proverbs chapter 1, verses 3 through 8. Proverbs 1, 3 through 8. He says, "To receive instruction in wise behavior, righteousness, justice, and equity. To give prudence to the naive, to the youth, knowledge and discretion. A wise man will hear and increase in learning, and a man of understanding will acquire wise counsel. To understand a proverb and a figure, the words of the wise and their riddles. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. Fools despise wisdom and instruction. So hear, my son, your father's instruction, and do not forsake your mother's teaching." Thirdly, faith without practicing the truth. Faith without practicing the truth that you learn, is a directionless faith. Faith without practicing the truth that you learn is a directionless faith. It is aimless. In fact, I want you to just hold your place there in Colossians, because we're going to look at a couple passages in James. But let's turn to James chapter 1. James chapter 1, beginning in verse 19. James here says, "This you know, my beloved brethren, but everyone must be quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to anger. For the anger of man does not achieve the righteousness of God. Therefore, putting aside all filthiness and all that remains of wickedness, in humility receive the word implanted, which is able to save your souls. But prove yourselves doers of the word, and not merely hearers who delude themselves. For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man who looks at his natural face in a mirror. For once he has looked at it, or looked at himself and gone away, he has immediately forgotten what kind of person he was. But the one who looks intently at the perfect law, the law of liberty, and abides by it, not having become a forgetful hearer, but an effectual doer, this man will be blessed in what he does." And I hope and pray that the illustration that I gave the other week or so of looking like I just crawled out of bed, no shower, getting myself prepped up, even forgot my glasses, was in sweatpants. Obviously, no responsible pastor would ever look like that, coming to church and preaching a message. But the point is, again, that we do not want to allow ourselves to look at the mirror and just walk away and forget about what we have just seen. And when we look into the Word of God, we want the Word of God to look into us so that it may change us. So faith without practicing the truth you learn is directionless faith and aimless. The next one, faith without fruit is a dead faith. Faith without fruit is a dead faith. Write this down, Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 to 23. Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 to 23. Of course, you would know this is the fruit of the Spirit. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. Now, you're there in James, right? Look again at James chapter 2. James chapter 2. Again, faith without fruit is a dead faith. Look at verse 14. What use is it, my brethren, if someone says he has faith, but he has no works? Can that faith save him? If a brother or sister is without clothing and in need of daily food, and one of you says to him or to them, go in peace, be warmed and filled, and yet you do not give them what is necessary for their body, what use is that? Even so, faith, if it has no works, is dead, being by itself. But someone may well say, you have faith and I have works. Show me your faith without the works, and I will show you my faith by my works. You believe that God is one, you do well. The demons also believe and shudder. But are you willing to recognize, you foolish fellow, that faith without works is useless? It's useless. He goes on to give illustration to Abraham. Now, Paul would also use this same illustration in the book of Romans to help us understand that it is by grace through faith, and that it was not works as intentional for him to gain his salvation, but it was all of grace. And James here is just basically saying, once you have come to this understanding that you are saved by grace and you truly have faith, it's going to spill over into good works. That's what he's trying to communicate here. Now, next, faith without continually increasing knowledge is a faith that is in bondage. Listen very carefully, folks. That is important. A faith that does not continue to grow, a faith that continually, it does not continue to increase in knowledge, is a faith that is in bondage. I don't know of any better example of that than me. I remember growing up, and you've heard me share this before, about being in a church that was highly legalistic. Highly legalistic. While we believe that we were saved by grace through faith, and yes, God kept us, we felt it very important that somehow we ought to display on the outside by our life, by this, by the way we look, by how short our hair was, how long the girls' dresses were, and whatever was that was necessary for them to do to show that they were a Christian, began to beat into my mind that it was all about appearance. And guess what would happen? I'd be sitting on that. Whenever I would come to church, guess where I was at? Front row. I mean, the preacher could have thrown, hit me, and knocked me out with something if he wanted to. I was that close. But I would turn around and look at all those other teenagers back on the back pew. Now, I knew what they were doing. They were cutting up because the preacher would calm them down every once in a while. But good old Jonathan Bradshaw up here on the front row, I'm a good Christian. And that's how I would establish my own faith. I would compare myself by looking at other people. And so I did not compare myself to God. Do you realize, folks, that you never, ever, ever compare yourself to other people? You always are in a state of comparing yourself to God. And you say, well, preacher, if that's the case, then I will never attain it. You are correct. That's why it's all of grace. That's why it is by grace through faith. not of yourselves. When we see other people, that frees us to say that when we see other people and they're not necessarily looking the way we think they ought to look, they're not acting the way we think that, guess what? We pray for them. We love them. We bear with one another. And by virtue of our interaction, guess what? We begin to grow together. But all that judgmentalism just kept me apart from those people on the back rows. But it kept me being judgmental to them. So without continually increasing knowledge, faith without a continually increasing knowledge is a faith that is in bondage. Do you realize how much bondage I was in? Write this down, Hosea chapter 4, verse 6. My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Because you have rejected knowledge, I will also reject you from being my priest. Since you have forgotten the law of your God, I also will forget your children. Write this down, John 8:32. Jesus says, you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free. Next, faith without relying on God's strength is a laborious and futile faith. Oh my goodness. Boy, is that ever true. A faith without relying on God's strength is a laborious and futile faith. Got a call from a fellow pastor this past week and just wanted to get some encouragement, I think. How do you, in light of what's going on right now, how do you maintain encouragement? Folks, I'm not going to lie to you. If I were to tell you that I have never been discouraged here at Long Branch Baptist Church, that would be a lie. And if I would tell you over this last year that there have been times of discouragement that have become so overwhelming, if I say that that's never happened, then that's a lie. You say, preacher, what encourages you? What encourages me is I know God's word is true. Regardless of what people do, regardless of what society forces upon us, whatever culture tries to emphasize in our lives, God's word is true. And there is something, and this is what I've learned, there is something to just enduring and trusting God, even when you don't know what's up around the bend. So faith without relying on God's strength is laborious and futile. Write this down, Psalm 20, verse 7. Some boast in chariots, some in horses, but we will boast in the name of the Lord our God. Do you know how many times in Israel's history they were surrounded by forces that were just, you couldn't overcome it? And by virtue of surrendering to God, God fought their battles. Mark chapter 10, verse 27. Looking at them, Jesus said, with people it is impossible, but not with God, for all things are possible with God. And one last one there, John 15, 5. He says, I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me, and we're going to see that same word here in our text here today, but who abides in me and I in him, he bears much fruit, for apart from me, you can do nothing. So folks, I'm telling you, if you're trying to live this Christian life in your own strength and under your own power, you are laboring. And all your efforts are futile. Next, faith without recognizing God's sacrifice for our salvation is an ungrateful faith. Faith without recognizing God's sacrifice for our salvation is an ungrateful faith. Write this down, Luke 11, verses 17 to 19. Luke 11:17-19. But he knew their thoughts and said to them, any kingdom divided against itself is laid waste, and a house divided against itself falls. If Satan also is divided against himself, how will his kingdom stand? For you say that I cast out demons by Beelzebul. And if it be Beelzebul that I cast out demons, by whom do your sons cast them out? They will be your judges. Romans chapter 1, verses 21 to 22. Romans 21 to 22. By the way, let me just go ahead and say, I think I misquoted a passage of Scripture. I got the wrong passage. I think it's supposed to be in Luke 17. But this is the story, the account where the lepers, there were 10 lepers. That's actually the story I was looking for. I was sitting there thinking, this is not the passage I wanted. But do you remember the story of those 10 lepers that came to Christ? And he said, go show yourself to the priest. He didn't heal them right away, but he says, go and show yourself to the priest. And as they left, that's when the healing took place. One stopped dead in his tracks, crying out with a loud voice, the Bible says, ran back to Jesus and fell at his feet. And Jesus said, where are the nine? This one Samaritan, this outcast, this half-breed, this reject from Israel, understood what gratefulness was. Now, Romans 1, 21-22, for even though they knew God, they did not honor him as God or give thanks. But they became futile in their speculation, and their foolish heart was darkened. Professing to be wise, they became fools. So faith without recognizing God's sacrifice for our salvation is an ungrateful faith. And finally, faith without remembering where you came from is a careless and forgetful faith. Faith without remembering where you came from is a careless and forgetful faith. Let's turn, if you will, over to Ephesians. Just turn to the left there, Ephesians chapter 2. Ephesians chapter 2. Have you ever stopped to just think about where you'd be if it wasn't for Jesus Christ? Where would I be if it weren't for Jesus? Look at verse 8. For by grace you have been saved through faith, that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not as a result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand so that we would walk in them. Now pay close attention to what he says here. Therefore remember that formerly you, the Gentiles in the flesh, who are called uncircumcision by the so-called circumcision, which is performed in the flesh by human hands, remember that you were at that time separate from Christ, excluded from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. I mean, that, can you imagine? This is what Paul is saying of the Gentile world. Guess what? That's you and me. Do you remember where you came from? Do you remember what he saved you out of? And I would say, as a young boy in a Christian family, I forgot and realized how much more dangerous it was for me to be living in a Christian home, because guess what? Everything sounds so good, and I get along, and I know the songs, I've heard the scripture verses. And for the longest time, I relied on that little prayer I prayed 3 times as a 5-year-old. And it wasn't until God gave me true understanding and he totally, by his grace, unexpectedly, just changed my heart. I just thought I was rededicating my life to Christ. Now, I believe at the age of 14, 15, somewhere around there, I was actually surrendering my heart to Christ. He goes on to say, but now, and I love but now, in Christ Jesus, you who formerly were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who made both groups into one and broke down the barrier of the dividing wall by abolishing in his flesh the enmity, which is the law of commandments contained in ordinances, so that in him he might make the two into one new man, thus establishing peace, and might reconcile them both in one body to God through the cross, by it having put to death the enmity. And he came and preached peace to you who were far away, and peace to those who were near. For through him we both have our access in one spirit to the Father. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, praise the Lord, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and are God's household, having been built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets. So he rescued us from the domain of darkness. He transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son. He gave us redemption and forgiveness of sins. Verses 15 to 20 there in Colossians basically helps us to see that he himself is the only one who was able to accomplish this.
Why?
Look at verse 22. Yet he has now reconciled you in his fleshly body through death. Here it is. In order to present you. In order to present you. How many of you guys remember show and tell at school? Most of the time, show and tell was not all that great until Christmas time, right? Because everybody got a chance to bring in what they got for Christmas. Show and tell, right? And we couldn't wait. Can you remember when it actually kind of mattered? Maybe you were junior high or high school, and you studied and studied and studied, and you brought home your report card, and you had an A. And your parents were so excited. You see, it was that reaction, that commendation, that affirmation that meant so much to you. It was the fact that you may be standing in front of all of your peers, your other fellow classmates, and seeing that your gift was the best one because it got all kinds of reaction. Can I tell you something, folks? Jesus did all of what he did to do one thing, and that is to present us to the Father. He rescued us to present us. This means, listen very carefully, you don't have to present yourself. You don't have to present yourself. See, you can't stand in the presence of God on your own. Scripture tells us very clearly that every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. You'll be able to stand outside of Christ, without Christ. You'll be able to stand toward God just like anyone else if they were to stand behind a F-16 fighter jet when it turns on its engines. It will melt you like that. But with Christ, we are clothed in his righteousness and perfected in him. You can't present yourself as holy. The word holy here in this text is pure, morally clean. You can't do that by yourself. You can't present yourself blameless, as the scripture says. That idea of nothing to accuse you of. Guess what? We have plenty to accuse us of, don't we? And that's why I believe in the book of Revelation, the Bible talks about books are going to be opened someday, containing the sins of mankind. Those intentional sins, sins of commission, sins that you committed knowing full well that you should not have done them. Sins of omission, those are sins that you committed when you knew you should have done something but you elected not to do it. Maybe fear, maybe pride, maybe hatred or indifference towards someone. But either way, it was a sin of omission. What about those unintentional sins? Maybe a kid grows up in the urban jungle, so to speak, and they don't know any better. They just think it's a way of life to steal and this, that, and the other. It's just what we do. Muslims today believe it's okay to lie as long as you're not lying to a fellow Muslim. Sins of the mind. Sins of the mind. The Bible tells us in Romans 2:16 that one day God is going to bring into account all sins, even those that are in secret. So see, you cannot stand before the presence of God without Christ. You can't present yourself holy without Christ. You can't present yourself blameless without Christ. And finally, you can't present yourself beyond reproach, that is, free from any legal charge. So you say, well, preacher, if I can't stand before God on my own, then what can I do? Fall on your knees. Fall on your knees before a holy God and allow Jesus to stand in your place. If I can't present myself holy, blameless, and beyond reproach, what can I do? Borrow from the holiness of Christ. Accept the imputed righteousness that only he can provide through his death, burial, and resurrection. And I love my passage of scripture, 2 Corinthians 5:21. He who knew no sin became sin for us so that we might be the righteousness of God in him. The power of if. Verse 23. Do you need to understand something, folks? As a Christian, continuity is crucial. YouTube is flooded. Young people, listen very carefully. YouTube is flooded. TikTok is flooded. Facebook is flooded. All types of social media are flooded by people, by young people who say, I tried that Christian thing, it didn't work. Or there's too much hypocrisy, this can't be true. Those Christians out there are so stupid, they believe that God created things in 6 days instead of millions and millions of years. They're idiots. There's too much proof. No, there's not. If you continue in the faith. Hebrews chapter 11 is the book of faith. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. And he goes through chapter 11 there, showing us exactly how people who did not even have the indwelling presence of the Holy Spirit were able to live by faith. And God accepted that. Do you realize, folks, that you are not getting into heaven? You're not getting into God's good graces by virtue of your faith. It is the faith of Christ. This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. And whoever is in Christ, God is pleased with us. If you continue in the faith, if you are firmly established, firmly rooted is what he's talking about there. If you are steadfast, not moved, that is, you're settled. There is no other choice. Christ is the only way. He is the way, the truth, and the life. And if you are not moved away from the hope of the gospel, John said it this way to anyone who removed themselves from the faith. He says, they went out from us because they were never really of us. The power of if implies that you depend on your own strength or abilities of power. Go back to verse 11 real quick, and we're about done. Paul made it very clear that we are strengthened with all power according to his glorious might. The if has already been taken care of in Christ. Let me ask you, what is your faith like? What has God shown you in these verses this morning? Galatians 4:19, my children, with whom I am again in labor, listen, until Christ is formed in you. Is Christ being formed in you? Ephesians 4:11 to 13, and he gave some as apostles and some as prophets and some as evangelists and some as pastors and teachers. Why? For the equipping of the saints, for the work of the service, to the building up of the body of Christ, until we all attain to the unity of faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a mature man or woman, to the measure of the stature which belongs to the fullness of Christ. Continuing in the faith. Do you have the faith? It's a good place to start. Wherever you are in this journey of faith, continue. Follow after Christ. Get into the Word of God. Let God's Word get into you. And let's continue together. Father, thank you for your Word. The big if was never intended to put a question mark in the mind of any Christian, any believer, to give anyone the idea that somehow this Christian faith depends on us, and maintaining this faith depends on us. But the if helps us to see. It gives us continuity. It helps us to understand that because we love God's word, because we love fellowshipping with fellow believers, because we enjoy getting the opportunity to share the gospel with those who need to hear it, because we have a hope in Christ for all of eternity, because of these things, because of the fruit of the Spirit, because these are things that are developing in us, Lord, it helps us to understand that we already belong to you. So God, I pray that as we examine our own hearts, we examine what we call faith, I ask, Lord, that you would reveal to us where we stand. Lord, may our faith not be empty words, but active with obedience. Lord, lead us and direct us here in this invitation time. May you be glorified. It is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.